So let's see. Let's get people a chance to get through commercials and stuff before I start talking too much. We are always here. Well, it's Twitch. We always are. Some way, form, other. Hi, welcome to today's stream. We are going to continue working in Gamemaker. As you can see, I don't have a lot up on my screen at the moment. You might see a few images change in the background. Those are the sprites I'm presently working with for the game. Hi, Dark Winter Dreams. So, to start out, let me start by saying happy human anniversary to everybody. It's 2 years now since Team Human got started, and I can only say yay for Team Human. It's been absolutely awesome these last 2 years, and of course meeting a lot of people before that as well. But these last 2 years, it's just been a bonus. So yay for Team Human. Well, I'm gonna fire up the Game Maker, because right now, I've run through a lot of different stuff to make ready for this, but it's probably easier to understand if I just start up in a clean game. So there we go. Hi, Binky. Welcome to the stream. Oh, there's always a kitty in the background fire. Oh, pretty regularly, anyway. There's three, and they tend to share that duty. Duty. Yeah. So, for starters, I need to make a new Game Maker file for a platform game. And I haven't really figured out a name yet. I know I'm gonna stuff it into my Game Maker library here. I'm gonna browse a bit, because I made a folder for platforms, just so if I make more than one, I can stuff them in there. Game Maker and platforms. So in here right now, I have basically a copy of the game I'm gonna make today with you. And if some of you are like, oh, I want to go through this a lot faster and want a lot of the coding, you should go to Yo-Yo Games webpage. The community manager, Sean Spaulding, does some really, really awesome tutorials, and they are the basis for everything I've done with this platform game so far. It's Sean Spaulding's tutorials. Of course, he is even more basic when it comes to the graphic than I am. So it'll be tutorials with a lot of little squares jumping about as the players and enemies. But the basic coding behind is sound. He is really good at his stuff. So, and as a community manager for GameMaker, he of course knows the program he's working with. So I'm gonna make a new one here. And there we go. And I'm gonna call it Platform Bear, because there was a general consensus, or at least a poll last time, that told me that this was gonna be about a bear. So Platform Bear is gonna be the name of this one. And create. So, like I talked about last times, there is a lot of pre-made folders for you here already to stuff into. And the main ones that we're working with is sprites, rooms, and objects. Sprites to put our graphics in, rooms to have some place that's levels, and objects to have all the stuff that you put into your levels. So, the very first object that I'm gonna start out on making is the player object. And to make the player object, I need some sort of a sprite to put in the background. So I'm going to start here by creating a new sprite. And I'm going to load one of my pre-made sprites here. Make sure I'm in the right folder. Platform. And in here, in my platform folder, I have the images I've been working with. So images. And I have one called, or I should have one, that one, player bear, open. Hi, the red one, welcome to the stream. So, this is my player object. Now, usually I would clip this all the way into the graphics, but right now, to kind of talk about good habits, I shouldn't clip this into the graphic. I should make sure that my graphic goes to the edges. So right now I'm gonna say that when this nice little bear is gonna collide with stuff, it's gonna be all the way to the edges of the image. I can always do another image for that. So I'm going into modify mask, getting this one here where you can see this areas that's shaded and areas that isn't. And all I do is click full image and the shade goes all the way to the edges, and this will be your collision box. Collision box is the area that determines when you're colliding with other stuff. So now here I have this one and I want its origin to be at the center. There we go, center. This is a one sprite image. This isn't made from a strip like the animation I showed you last time. It's just like a simple image frame to be a placeholder for if I need to put other animation in there at a later point. So let's just go ahead and say, okay, I like this one. Let's call it sprite player. SPR underscore player. It's a good idea to be pretty consistent about how you name your stuff, because when you do coding, you're going to have to refer back to certain stuff. Like when I want my my player to run left or right, I want them to use a different sprite than this one. So inside my code, I'm going to be able to reference the names of the different sprites I'm using. So this is sprite player, and this isn't just sprite player, this is sprite player idle. Because this is a player when they are doing absolutely nothing. So let's say okay, I'm pretty happy with this one. And then just because, yeah, keep it simple. And there's a reason why I do this SPR underscore in the beginning. That way, if I ever get confused about my files, everything named SPR will be a sprite. Anything named OBJ will be an object. So it's a bit like that. So I have my first sprite ready. And let's just go in and look, not at this one, let's close this one down. Close without saving. And let's open up the one I was working on so I can show you how I did it. Well, I thought it should be a pretty happy bear, because there was kind of a consensus around a bear, and the bear that I know is, of course, benighted. Now, you can see this is our bear. There's some stars and stuff around there I can just remove, because, like last time, I did everything in layers. So, if I turn everything off here, we can start out looking at how I've been doing this. So the first thing I started with was the head. Then, like with the egg, I did the eyes and the irises. Then I put on a snout. And then I put on ears. Then I put on eyebrows, and you might notice that this doesn't look like eyebrows, it just made a tiny change with the eyes here. But the reason I have the eyebrows is because if I should at some point choose to animate this bear to look, let's say angry, I can take this area here and move it down, and it will entirely change the look of the character I'm working with. So it's a simple way of making an image that's set up to be animated. See? Really unhappy bear right now. Then we've got the body. You can see I've pretty much stuck to the recipe from last time, where I'm just using the ellipses tool in GIMP to paint out everything. So it's all just a series of ellipses. The nose is ellipses, then there's a box down here. I had to do like a bit of freehand, but I could just do it on one part, and then I mirrored it and put that on the other part as well. So that works. The arms, again, pretty simple. And behind everything, I have two lines. I have my central horizontal line, and I have my center vertical line. You can see these tiny black bits sticking out here. If I start turning stuff off, you'll see there's this cross behind everything. I'm using this to make sure that that my animations aren't pretty much around the same center when I start moving stuff around. Just remember, before you save anything, turn off your crosses and make sure all the body parts are showing that you want to show. So the way it looks like this, that is my idle sprite. So let's just close this one down again. Don't save, let's just keep it the way it was. And let's start looking at the actual object, the player object. So I'm going to go in, create object. And here, when it says sprite, when I click out here, because I already made the sprite in the sprite section, I can just choose my player idle sprite as the sprite. This is going to be visible. I'm not marking solid or anything like that, because I'm going to make sure that I do my collisions with coding. So, how do we do coding? Last time, I very shortly mentioned a little bit about events and stuff you can do in events, all the different kind of pre-made code we have over here. But if you want to have 100% control of what you're doing, you're going to have to write code, and the only pre-made code you use is going to be the functionalities that's already built into GameMaker. And there's a lot of material that you can get on that that I will show you as we go along. A lot of it appears inside GameMaker, luckily, so you don't have to be too dependent on external sources. So, I'm going to go out here where I have a lot of tabs, and I'm going to pick my control tab. And in here, I have this area that says code. This is the one thing that I use the most when I work with this. Oh, okay. I have to add an event, of course. Right here, we have a group of events. There's a lot of different events that can happen. And these events are all aimed right now at the object I'm working with, that means my player character. And the first event I'm going to create is a create event. So this kind of is the place where I fill in the code that needs to be there when the player is created. Oh, my phone is buzzing like crazy. Let's see. Stuff is happening. Yeah, let's put that in a more soundproof area. So, this is a create event. A create event, it is usually you don't stuff too much code in here, just the bits that you need to have absolutely present when you start out. Let me get my different stuff in place on the screen. So, what we put in here in the beginning, I'm going to start out by doing a comment. I'm making this with these two lines. Everything I write will turn green when I have this here. These two slashes, forward slashes. So I'm going to write initialize variables. There we go. That's kind of the headline of what I'm going to do right now. The variables are facts about the player that the player have to be, the player character have to keep in it at all times. And since this is a platform game, you have to think about what to put in there. You have, you know, you need some movement in there because your object needs to be able to move. And you need to put something about jumping as well because, well, it's a platform game. You need to be able to jump. So first, I'm gonna put in some different things about speed and what I want speed to be when I start out. I'm doing a game from scratch, Megavoxel, and welcome to the stream. This is pretty much the start of the program. The last stream I did, I was mainly talking about how to do simple graphics and a little bit about the built-in coding functionalities that there is in GameMaker. So this is the beginning of how to make a platform game from scratch, based on the tutorials made by Sean Spaulding on Yo-Yo Games. Not everything I do will be exactly the same, because names and stuff change from game to game. So, initialize variables. First of all, my character needs to be able to move sideways, which is horizontal. We're going to use everything that's sideways, whether it's one way or another, we're going to call that horizontal speed. So I'm going to say HSP, horizontal speed. And when I start out, I want my character to stand still, so I'm going to put that to 0. Now you have to be aware that you don't call it H-speed here. You can pretty much make up your own name for a variable. But as you see here, I get a suggestion when I write HSP. It suggests that I write H-speed. That's because that's a variable that's already built into GameMaker. And if I'm using that one, I won't be able to know exactly what's going down underneath the game, because it won't be my exact code. So instead of doing the H speed from GameMaker, I'm just doing my very own horizontal speed variable here. So, and it's set to 0 at start because we don't want the object to move. Next one is going to be my vertical speed, pretty much on the same principle. You are not going to have any vertical speed when the game starts out, so that's going to be a 0 as well, like that. Oh, and a good thing about these comments that we have up here, there's in GameMaker, if you instead of two slashes, you make three slashes, this will make this the name of your code up here. If I OK this one, you can see up there it changed its name to initialize variable, because when I do three comment lines forward slashes, it'll grab that and put it as the name of the script. That could be a pretty good thing to keep order if you have a lot of events happening in your objects. Hi Sol, welcome to the stream. And hi Seraphim, good to see you. So those were the two first variables. When I put these to 0, it's because, of course, I'm going to change them later, but I'm not going to do that in the create event. The create event is simply there to state how things are going to be at the moment the game starts out and what variables that my object will need to be able to live the right way in this game. So, going to the next one, There is in a platform game, you need to jump. There's some built-in gravity functions in Gamemaker, but once again, I went with the option of saying, oh, I want to know 100% what's in my code. So I'm going to do my own gravity variable as well. I'm going to call it grav. If you see here again, once again here, it wants to tell me that I can just use a variable. It has two to choose from that starts with grav. But if I do that, I don't know what's going on. So I keep my own grav. And the graph that I'm working with is 0.2. If you're not happy with this 0.2, if I'm not happy with this gravity, I can always go in and change it later. I can make it be faster or slower and change the entire way it looks when you're falling and jumping. But 0.2, it would look pretty good with the stuff that I've been doing. Now, there is also the question of what is the maximum speed I want my character to be able to move. With this, I'm mainly thinking backwards and forwards, horizontal line, because if I don't put a cap on it, I might somewhere in my code by accident set it to be able to go boom out there. So accelerating out the side of the screen if you haven't put up any wall objects. So let's make sure that we have a move speed that we can work with. And I'm just going to call that move speed. And move speed is not the speed, as you can see, this is what the speed is right now. That would be my HSP, my horizontal speed, which is zero at the moment, but it could be, if the right conditions were there, that move speed could go up to be 4. And cheers to everybody. Thank you very much for coming. And let me repeat my happy human anniversary to all the humans present and those who doesn't know what team, not human, but human. Those who don't know what that is, go look it up. We are an awesome community. Let me see, I've got people talking to me. Okay. Human, that's right, Welshie. We are all human present. Okay, now, this is all I'm really going to start out with. Let's see. If you think about why I'm looking up, it's because I have a load of notes on the screen above to make sure that I get all the right things into this, because I might have went a bit ahead in the tutorials and coded some part of the games that we're not going to get through tonight. I want to make sure that I don't put code in there that's just going to confuse you. So we have our horizontal speed, vertical speed, our gravity, and our movement speed. That's like the movement speed we want when it moves horizontal. Now, we want to think about jumping as well. We need to set, like we have a move speed, we need to make sure that we have a jump speed. Now I already know that somewhere in this game I'm going to have a power-up option, because that's something you often have. You touch something or you collect a coin and all of a sudden you get extra abilities, and in this case that extra ability is you're going to be able to jump a little bit higher when you get one of these power-ups. So I'm going to do jump speed underscore normal, and I'm gonna set that to, what did I pick? I put that to 8 and a semicolon, and I am going to do another jump speed that is going to be the jump speed for power-ups. So The language is a Gamemaker language. So it's a language made specifically for working with the Gamemaker game creator engine. So if you want to kind of refer it to something, it's a lot. It reminds me a lot of when I work with Java and a bit of Flash and stuff like that. It's mainly based on being able to make it's Flash games you're gonna make with this. But it is GameMaker's very own language. It's a very simple language. A lot of the things that you work with, if you are working with like XML or Visual Basic or stuff like that, it's just isn't there because they've taken care of a lot of that in this GameMaker creator. Because they know that it's going to be used for one thing, which is making games. And when we make games, there's a lot of things that's already going to be given, preset, or stuff like that. So, well, that was a long explanation for a short question. I hope you got an answer. So, jump speed normal, I'm going to put that one to 8. And another jump speed, I'm going to do a jump speed for my power up. And I'm going to put that to 10. When I go in and I make some functions, you'll be able to see how this is going to be used in the math inside the functionalities. Some of you might wonder why I don't just do my variables locally within each piece of code, each event in the object. But my experience is that it's very nice to have variables you can work with throughout an object or throughout a game. So at a later point, I'm gonna talk a bit about global variables, but I promise myself I'd try to stay away from that today. Right now, just focus on the simple things. So, this here is our initial create code. I'm just going to say OK to that and put that away. There we go. This was my create event. Now, the next interesting event is the step event. The best way to describe a step event is actually like this. If I create a room here, I don't know if you remember from last time I talked a bit about Seraphim. I like GameMaker because it was one of the first things that actually came out as a game creating machine, and I wrote a project on it when I studied game design about the future of games made through programs like this, where a normal user would no longer have to be proficient in everything. They would just have to be able to use one of these programs, and I was very fascinated with it. It was not at all at the level that it is now, because it's a few years ago now. But already back then, it was pretty mind-blowing to me to take all the hassle of having to sit and do your code from scratch, taking a huge amount of that code and putting it into this creator so people can just pull it out when they need it. So I hope that kind of answers it. I'm self-taught in GameMaker, but I'm also I have a degree in computer science. I'm specialized in game design and in algorithms, solving puzzles, or making the code to solve puzzles. So that's why. Okay, back here. I was explaining about, let's see my notes, I was explaining about step events. In here we have this area when I make a room. A room has a speed, and a speed is what everyone who games knows as the frames per second. Steps per second, of course, it here, but what it really is it translates to frames per second, but also how many times objects go through the process of going through their code. And in this case, if I choose a step event, and this is set to 60, which is a nice smooth speed for the room, my object is going to go through the step event code 60 times a second. So 60 times a second, it's going to check up on everything that's in that code and make sure that it's doing what it's supposed to do. So I'm going to do room with a speed of 60. We're just going to call it room 1. I'm going to make it a bit taller. Let's make it 1400. Oh, that was width. I don't want 1400. Let's do that. 1100 times 1400. I'm going to do something with some viewpoints I'm going to show you as well. So this was mainly it. I put the speed to 60. So when I go into my object here and I add an event, like a step event, it's going to run whatever is in this code I'm going to put in here for 60 times a second. So that means this is where I put the code where my object reacts to its surroundings, because I want it to be at all times aware of what the hell is happening in the room it's in, and what it's supposed to do about it, if it's supposed to do anything. So the step event is usually where you're going to end up having the majority of your code. So once again, because I want to control everything, I'm going down to the control tab out here. I'm going to choose code, and I'm going to drag a piece of code in there. There we go. So create event first, initialize variables, and now I have my variables because I made them here. This tells me what I'm going to do with them. So let me just move some of my notes up here. That's the step event. Yes. First of all, we put in some variables. We called them HSP for horizontal speed, VSP for vertical speed, move speed, jump speed. But so far, if I kind of turned the game on and I tried to push buttons, nothing would happen. Nothing would move. Because I need to make sure that the computer knows which keys I'm supposed to press to be able to use these variables. So that's what I'm going to tell it right here. I'm going to start out by saying, let's say, get player input. There we go. Now, there's two ways that people are used to playing games. Some people are pretty happy about the arrow keys. I'm more of a WASD player, but I'm going to write it with the arrow keys, and then I'm going to afterwards delete that and show you how I would do it with the letter keys. So I'm going to do a variable. I'm going to call it keyWrite to tell that this is the key that I'm going to use to move right. And let's make sure that I do this right. Underscore and no big letters. I'm doing my best to stay away from capital letters when I code, unless it's absolutely necessary, because otherwise it can be a pain to remember when you use capital letters and when you use small letters. So keep it to the small letters as much as you can. I'm going to do what we call a keyboard check. So I'm going to say keyWrite means that the cat is coming by here, apparently. Let's just see. One kitty. There we go. And down we go. So keyWrite means check underscore. Oh, wait. Wrong order. You can see. It's been a while since the last time I did this keyboard. And now, when I put the underscore, it's going to offer me a lot of options, a lot of functions that's already built into GameMaker. Here. And the one that I want in the beginning here is the simple one at the top that just says keyboard check key, which means that the computer is going to find out what key am I pressing now. So keyboard check, and there was these brackets, standard brackets, and inside of them I'm going to write what key I'm using. In the case of the arrow keys, I mean, this is virtual keyboard underscore, and it is, let's see, VK write. GameMaker recognizes this as one of the buttons on my keyboard. So now if I push the right button in here, the computer is going to say, oh, she means this value called key write. Okay. What it also does is that if I press down the right arrow key, this is the interesting, boring coding part I've been talking about, was she? So, when I press the right key, this is running every 60 times every second, it's going to say for a lot of the time I'm not pressing the key, all of a sudden I'm pressing the key. If I'm not pressing the key, key write is going to be zero. If I'm pressing the key, this keyboard check is going to return a one. So this key write over here is going to be returns either a zero or one, which means it returns a number that I can use to do some math with, and I'm going to do that later on, of course. Then we've got our key left. You might already know what I'm going to write here, because it's pretty much the same. So, let's get keyboard underscore check. And the key I'm going to ask for, I'm touching this one this time, is virtual keyboard left arrow. There we go. And as the one above it, let's put all these comments on the same line. There we go. I'm going to do something here, and this is for my math, because I want to be able to use my right and left key to very clearly see what way I'm turning. Now, if I did key left exactly the same way that I did key right, then no matter if I was using key right or key left, it would return a 1 or a 0. But I want to make sure that key right gives me a 1. But if I press this one, I'm going to get a minus one. I'm going to do that very simple by putting a minus in front of keyboard check. That makes sure that if I don't press the key, it'll return a zero. If I press a key, it'll take a one and turn it into a minus one and return a minus one. Yeah, it's a true or false, exactly. Key write is like a variable that I invented. I could have called it anything I wanted to, but it is a true or false whether the keyboard check is the one that returns the true or false and stuffs it into the key write. And I'm going to show you how to do the letters right after this. I have a tendency to comment a lot because I have ended up teaching a lot of the stuff I do. And it's a good thing to have these as notes. So when you go back through your programming, if you can't remember why you did it, if you, for instance, copied it from a tutorial, and you have an error you can't explain, this out here might help you explain it. The comments. And everything that's green and a comment does not get counted as code. So anywhere in your code where you feel the need to put in a comment to explain to yourself what the hell you were doing, put in these two forward slashes and write it down. Just advice. I'm not always good at it either, but I've learned in time that it'll save me a lot of hassle. So, some people were asking, or rather Binky was asking, what about the D key? Well, if I was going to do a D key, this is like a virtual keyboard. Left, right, and stuff like that. If you want to do letter keys, you do it slightly different. So, for instance, up here in key right, let's just remove this. I would instead, because the right direction would be a D, I would write ORD, put in another bracket, put in quote marks or citations marks around a capital D, and make sure I get this bracketed off. This here is how you use the letter keys if you want to go with a WASD. Yeah, exactly. Exactly, Binky. I've had some times where I went back through code that I just wrote down because I thought that was a good idea, and it worked, and then I added a function and something stopped working, went back through my code, and because I didn't comment anything, or I called the variable something that just wasn't logical, it was just ugh. So brackets are important, Welshie, but I'm going to show you something here. If I remove this bracket, you'll notice that down here now there's an error message, and it tells me very clearly at line 3, position 2. Now this is where it's wrong, because it's not always at the line it says if it's a bracket error. Because all it does here is count downwards and say in this area, somewhere a bracket wasn't closed. If I go back up here and put in the bracket that's supposed to be there, the error message goes away. Now, if you have one of those and you're not sure where in the code it is, you can do this. You can go in, let's remove that one again, and say, okay, I'm going to just comment out this line of code by doing that. Now that's a comment. There's still an error. So if the error is still there, it wasn't in that line because that line is no longer code. It's just a comment. So that's a way of doing that. Oh yeah, I know that. Yeah, Binky. Years and years later, you look at it and think, what the heck did I just do back then? I wonder if I could do that again. So up here, I still have my arrow. I commented that one out, so it wasn't that line. So my arrow is up here. And it says it misses a symbol or a bracket. Well, if I start counting, two pointing that way, only one pointing that way. Let's put one more pointing that way. And let's go in here and let's remove the comments. Now, one thing I forgot here that I'm supposed to remember, and this is, you have to get it in from the beginning. In most other coding languages, semicolons are pretty darn important. In GameMaker, not so much. You can do a lot of code without semicolons. But at times, if you do everything without semicolons, all of a sudden you might end up with a piece of code that isn't really split into the pieces of code it should be. So do yourself a favor and remember what I just forgot. Put in your semicolons when you do this. Semicolons kind of means I'm done with this, I'm moving on to the next thing. So this is our key right. Right now it's a D down there. It's a left, virtual keyboard left. Instead of virtual keyboard left, that would of course turn into, let's remove that. ORD, Command E, A, like that. Key left, key right. I tried fiddling back and forth to make it respond to both. So it would be both my arrow keys and my WASD, but I ran into some errors. As soon as I figure out why, I'll come back and tell you how you can make it do both so you don't have to worry about whether a player or not is playing right-handed or left-handed. So, well, that was our horizontal directions fixed there. Let's see, what was the next part? That was get player input. Exactly, key jump. We need to get the key jump in there as well. So, key underscore jump. Once again, this is a name I made up, or rather Sean Spaulding made up. I could have called this, instead of key jump, I could call it goat. Only problem is, if I call it goat, go back to the code later, I'll probably won't remember what the hell goat meant. So I'm going to call it key jump because it's logical. And because there's a chance I can figure out later, then this is what this part of the code was doing. So, when I do a key jump, space key is... that's my Discord making noises. Key jump, I'm going to use the space key because I think that's what everybody's used to using when you do space key. And I'm going to do keyboard check. But it's going to be a slightly different keyboard check, this one. So let's see here. Keyboard check. Keyboard underscore check, even. Underscore. Now you can see I only have three things to choose from here. Released, pressed, or direct. What I want to know here is, did someone press the space key? If the space key was pressed, and some other conditions that I'm going to come into later are there, I want my character to be able to jump. I don't want my character to be able to jump in free air, but I'm going to fix that in a little bit as well. So I'm going to check keyboard check pressed. And I'm going to put VK underscore space, my jump key. And remember to close my brackets. Move my comments out a bit more. And remember my semicolon here. So, these are like the things that the player can do to make his character do something. You can either go left, you can go right, or you can jump. That's kind of the standards in a platform game. So it was, let me just take a moment to see what people are writing in chat. And welcome to everyone I haven't been seeing. And let's see. Oh, I got a new follower. Did it do the follower alert? I put it up to do a follower alert, but I'm not sure it did that. Okay. Yeah, Anders is here by my side as usual until it's time for Anders to go to bed. He, after all, has a job to take care of, and I don't at the moment. So. Key jump. We check that. We made a variable to stuff it into. Now this one, once again, is going to return a 0 or 1. I didn't make that anything negative about this one. So it'll just return either 0 or 1. And as it was commented earlier, what this means is this is a true or false expression. Either it's pressed or it's not. It can't be both. So it will be either 0 or 1, or in this case up here, 0 or minus 1. So I think that's all I can stuff into that explanation on these three lines of code. If anyone has any more questions about these three lines of code, feel free to tag me in chat and throw a question at me. And I'll remind those who haven't heard it before that this is based on Sean Spaulding's platform tutorial from Yo-Yo Games website. Sean Spaulding is the community manager of Yo-Yo Games, who does the Gamemaker engine. So, now, I've got the player input, and I need to somehow respond to that. Because once again, all I've done is checked whether or not I've got a 1 or a 0, or a minus 1, or 1 or a 0 here. I haven't really done anything with it yet. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to run the player input. There's probably some better headlines for this, but this is what I called it. Run player input. And this player input is going to be run through a little bit of math to make sure that it does the things that we want it to do. So, the first one we're going to run through is we're going to figure out whether or not you're actually running left or right and set your move speed according to that. So, part one. I'm going to make a new variable. I'm going to call it move. And I'm going to make it the result of whether or not I'm going key right or key left. So move equals key right plus key left. Okay. Now, this gives me, oh, let's make sure there's no big letters in there. That can go horribly wrong, because the moment I do a spelling error, it won't be the same as this up here. The computer will see it as something entirely on its own. So, my key right, as you remember, can give a 0 or 1. My key left can give a 0 or minus 1. And if you, by any chance, should be pressing both of them down, you will have if you press the right key, you will get a 1. If you press the left key, you will get a minus 1. So if both keys are pressed, you will get a 1, and your move will be 1. If only your right key is pressed, you will get a 1. The result will be a 1. If you only press your left key, you will get a minus 1. So, the three results you can get from this is a 1, a 0, or a minus 1. So that means that a 1 means I'm moving to the right, a 0 means I'm standing still, and a minus 1 means I'm moving to the left. The red one, to some sort, I tried running some of that code earlier, and it worked fine for my key right, where I had no negative statements. I had this little minus wasn't here. When I did that, I could just go up and I could write or between, and then I could put the other expression over there. So I could have keyboard check or to D or keyboard check virtual key right. But in this line, my left line, where I worked with a negative value, couldn't get it to work. Tried with tried bracketing it in different ways, couldn't get it to work. But I'll get back when I figure out why not, and try to explain to you why not. So right now we have this variable called move. It will tell us whether we are going left, right, or standing still based on these numbers up here. So let's go out there and put a comment on that. Let's see. Result tells direction. 1 equals right. 0 equals none. And minus 1 equals left. Now, why 1 and minus 1? Some of you might be thinking, what's the logic about that? And I'm going to take us on a little detour again, go back to graphics, and talk a little bit about why these are the values we're using. So, let's save this for a little bit, and we'll get back to that as well. I'm going to open up my sprite here. Let's just say, edit the sprite. Now, there is a coordinate system inside a computer. And everything in a 2D game like this has an x-axis, that's the horizontal axis, and a y-axis, that is the vertical axis. This point up here in the upper left corner is 0.0 of this picture. If I go into a room, the upper left corner of the room will be 0.0. So this little piece of graphic has its very own coordinate system, and a room has its own coordinate system, and these are like the x and y coordinates you use to place graphics with. So yeah, I was thinking something like that, Binky. I just haven't had time to play around with it, but feel free to message me something about it in Twitter, and I'll make sure to look into that when I get time to play around with it next time. So, and that's for everyone. If you have code comments that I don't answer while I'm streaming, feel free to throw them at me in my Twitter, and I'll do what I can to get back to you if there's anything that needs an answer or something you want cleared up. Or just a good idea you want to throw at me. That's always welcome as well. So that was like the coordinate system. Now, when I move horizontally, this is 0. This is positive. So right, if I move this way, it will be a positive number. If I move left from the 0, I will move in the negative direction. So left is a negative number. That's why I put my right to 1 and my left to negative 1. If I turn them around, it won't make sense logically when I do the coding compared to what I know about the x and y axis that is used on the graphics in the game. I hope that made sense. Oh yeah, your name is on the desktop. That's the recipe you sent me, Red One. Right here. I've got a recipe from the Red One from when he came by to visit me. So I'm gonna close this one up again. Make sure that the mask is the way it's still the way it's supposed to be. Yeah. There we go. So that was the explanation about why it's important to use 1 and minus 1. If someone out there is really proficient in coding, I'm sorry if I'm boring you by going into so much detail. I just think that a lot of people talking about code kind of expects people to already know a lot about it already. And this is Gamemaker was made to make it possible for people without a lot of coding experience to go into it. So the fact that it works the best when you write code, someone needs to go into detail and explain it a bit more. So, okay. That was my move variable. Now, it gives me a 1 or minus 1 or 0. So what am I going to use that for? I'm going to use that to combine with my movement speed. Remember in create, I set a movement speed to 4. And that's because I want to make sure that my horizontal speed, you remember this little variable that was set to 0 in the beginning? Yeah, my horizontal speed is going to be equal to my move variable from this step event times move speed. Oh, I don't know if you can hear it, but my cats discovered there's only an hour till their feeding time.
So if that keeps up, I'm going to have to put them in the kitchen. Yeah, especially one of them. The people who's been here know which one that is. So,
move times move speed, and the result of this will be either 0, because I got 0, no keys were pressed. It'll be 4, because if you remember in my creation code, my move speed was 4 times 1, and I'll be going 4 in the direction right with 4. Or it's going to return a negative 4, because minus 1 times 4 is minus 4, and it's going to move to the left. So, well, the point is, it's not supposed to be that that complicated, Red. A lot of coding is really, really logic, but you still need some kind of introduction into it to make sure that... I mean, I tried at some point before I got into coding to do stuff from tutorials. And let's just say that tutorials are really nice, but if you don't know what you're talking about, all you can do is copy, and it won't be an intelligent copy because you don't know what you're copying. So, as a comment out here, I'm gonna write move speed to the left or right or standing still. Now, to get back to variables, if I, instead of using this move variable here, I could have just gone in up here and say if keyboard check for this one is going to be not key right, not the variable key right. I could just put a 1 there and a minus 1 there where I wanted them. But then I would have to repeat the code down here. I would have to make a code for each of these values. Instead of here now, I can just pull in whatever is in my value, either 0 or 1 or 0 or minus 1. So variables are pretty great at storing results and then get access to that results for doing later calculations. So what we have here, that is like our horizontal check. If I'm moving left or right, or if I'm standing still, and if I'm moving, how fast I'm moving, back to the HSP. So next check we're going to do is we are going to do a vertical check. Let's just put in here for kicks horizontal. Now if I go down here, we're still in the run player input. Let's put that one with a capital. I can put capital letters in my comments if I want to. I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna write vertical. So, the next check we're doing, and let's get our comment line back up where it's supposed to be. Okay. So, this might seem like a lot of thinking, but that is what tutorials are for. Once again, I'm recommending Sean Spaulding, the community manager from YoYo, because he is very good at explaining while he is doing the code. And if you're smart and use the pause buttons a lot and write comment into your code as you're doing it, he's a really, really good source for getting good solid code with an explanation of what you're going to do with it. Gonna need to get this one off. It's turning hot. So,
I'm going to check some things about the vertical. So up here I have my key jump, right? Let's get this part out of the screen from the other. This on top there. I am going to start out by checking my vertical speed, my VSP. Now, if you can remember, we put a variable called VSP into the create. Let's do this once. So, in here, I created VSP and set it to 0. So when the character starts out, it should be at 0. It can do all kinds of stuff. As you can see here, we're talking vertical, so it's the jump speed. So if I was just in the middle of a jump, I'd have a vertical speed of 8. If I was in the power, I'd have a vertical speed of 10. So let's close this one down again. I'll go back into the step code where we're doing this. Once again, because we want the player object to keep on checking these conditions. So, let's see, what did I write last time? If vertical speed is less than 10, 10 is kind of an arbitrary number that you can play around with and see what fits what you've done. Because the different speeds will look different with different size graphics. So you might want to go in and tweak both your vertical speed or your horizontal or your move speed. If it looked like it's going too fast or too slow compared to the graphic you end up doing. So I'm just saying 10 because, well, it works. So if this is true, the vertical speed is below 10, I'm gonna add gravity. So I'm gonna go in here, and now I'm gonna do some of the funny brackets. So one funny bracket there, one ending funny bracket, and this is what you do with the brackets, will you? You simply start out by doing a set. And when you have the set, you type between them. That way you're always sure that you have the amount of brackets that you need. Well, pretty sure, unless you do a lot of brackets in between. But always make them as a pair and then type in between. Just works better that way. So, VSP plus equals grav. Once again, it's trying to make me choose one of its variables, gravity or gravity direction, but I'm going with the one I established myself in the create event, graph, a number that I can go in and change if I'm not happy about it. So, what does plus equal means? Basically, what it means is that every time it runs through this one, as long as VSP is below 10, it's going to add the value of graph to VSP. So plus equals is the same as saying vertical speed equals vertical speed plus gravity and stuff that back into the VSP value. So that's next time it checks, that will be the value. So if you can, if you say I have a vertical speed of 9.9, my graph is 0.2, the first time I run through it, no problems. I'm going to add 0.2 to my graph. Gives me to 10.1. Second time I run through it, oh, I'm above 10. It's not going to do this. Okay? So it's kind of a condition. If this is true, I'm going to do this. It's the wiggly bracket, Welshie. It's the wiggly bracket. Yeah, we have like three different kind of brackets. We have like the normal brackets, then we've got the squiggly brackets, and then we have the square brackets. They all serve different purposes. Your normal brackets is just to put an expression in this is to kind of do, if you do a condition like this, with, if you say if this is true, then, and you put this in a normal bracket afterwards, what you're going to do if it's true, you would usually put that in square brackets. So far, so good. Now, there is something else I want to make sure of if you're going to jump. I want to make sure that you're actually standing on something. So, we're going to do some collision checks. Also for running, because the point is, if you are running and you don't have anything to run on, you should fall. So, we're going to do some collision checking. Now, you can do collision checking, like I showed you with the sprite, on the sprite and by doing objects as solid. But if you want to make sure you get a picture-perfect collision, where one object always will go to the edge of another object and don't overlap, it's a good idea to write this in a piece of code. What will happen if two pieces of graphic overlap? Well, they might have problem moving afterwards. So if you get graphic stuck in graphic, somewhere a collision check went wrong. Yeah, you can do an if on one line, but I'm trying to put in some, let's say, good practices of coding while I'm doing this. And it's better to do some of these things every time when you start out, so you remember you're supposed to do it about the brackets. Because otherwise you're going to be inconsistent in your coding. And if you start, that's okay later on when you know what you're doing. But if, in the beginning, it's pretty important that you stick to a set of rules. So, I have this condition here. Now, I'm going to do some collision checks. So, let's see here. You're going to start out with... we're going to check out if they're standing on something. Yeah. So, let's do a collision check. Let's do some... comment. Collision check. And I'm going to put in a bracket. Am I standing on something? Something. Yeah, I have to make sure it's not going to be some thong. That happens once in a while. Don't know where I got that from. This is going to be a little bit of a longer piece of code, so I'm going to take a little bit of time. So, I'm going to use a function that's already in GameMaker. So, if place meeting. Now, if I go a little bit back here, you can see here, in this function, it says place meeting, and then inside this bracket, this set of brackets, it has x, point y, point object. So what it wants to know is x and y, I mean coordinates, and it wants to know what object you're checking if you're colliding with. So, I'm going to put that in. So, I want to know if right below me there is something. So, meeting, let's put in here, just for starters, x, point, y, point, and I'm going to put an object in here that I haven't created in, yet, but I'm going to create in a minute. OBJ underscore wall. This is going to be the object that I use to build the areas that you're going to jump around. Now this right here would be not quite efficient, because the thing is I want to check right below me. And below me, that's on the y-axis. So, and the y-axis when we talk about GameMaker this way, we have zero up here, and then we actually have positive values downwards. So it's not like your mathematical coordinate system where you're used to watching your y-axis with positive up here and negative down here. Instead, you have negative down, positive downwards and negative upwards. So I'm going to check if y plus 1, one pixel below me, is there something, and is that an object wall? So that's kind of the condition I'm going to test. And then I need to say, what do I want to do if there is a wall below me? We are going to make sure that if there's something below me, I'm gonna have some jump speed available if I press the jump key, the key jump, the one we put up here. So, onwards. And when I'm looking up again, I'm checking my notes because I had to run through this weekend while I did a lot of other stuff as well. So, went through that. And collision check, there we go. I'm gonna set my brackets, first of all, so I know that I have them. Bracket. Bracket, move it into the bracket. Go in here. ESP equals key jump. If you remember, key jump will return either a 0 or a 1. And I'm gonna multiply that with negative jump speed. There we go. The reason it's keep doing that, and I never have time to fix it. I always forget. Now, the reason this one is negative is back to the y-axis. If it's negative, you're gonna actually move up if you press the space key. But since we have the key jump as a value here, if the space key wasn't pressed, if you're standing on something and you didn't press the space key, this will be a 0. So 0 times anything is 0, so nothing's gonna happen. But if you're standing on something and you're pressing the key jump, you're gonna get a 1, and then your jump speed is gonna be one of the two jump speeds in the create event. Either the 8 that was the normal. So, or the power up. Let me just check that I did my variables correct. I'm pretty sure I did. Jump speed, normal, jump speed. If I did it wrong, we're gonna find out when I use it. So, this was my collision check, whether I'm standing on something, can I jump? Let's put that in there as well. Now, besides whether or not there's something below you, there could be something beside you as well. There could be a wall in the room you're in. So if you don't want to run into walls, you have to make sure that you make a collision check horizontally as well. So let's look at that. This is a bit like the one I already did, but let's... not quite, they're never quite the same. If they were, I would reuse them. I would not do them separately. Horizontal collision.
And feel free to hang in chat and have fun with each other. I know a lot of you do that. No hard feelings, and you can always go back and check the video if there's something you feel that you missed out on. So I'm gonna go here to my horizontal collision, and I'm gonna do again if place meeting. And that one was supposed to be a bracket and not an 8. If place meeting, this one needs to. Hang on. These are the bracket things when you get distracted. Make sure you've got all of them. If place meeting, and we know from the last time that it's going to be an X and Y and the object wall, because I'm going to build the floors and the walls out of the same object. So we're going to put in the beginning in here, X point Y point OBJ underscore wall. Now you can see two of these values are red and one of them is white. The white one here means that right now GameMaker doesn't know what this is, the object wall. If I go in here, create an object, call it obj underscore wall, same thing I called it down here, and just say, okay, an empty object. This turns red because now GameMaker knows that this is an object and that it's in the object library up here. So. Well, I want to check if I'm moving, and I'm moving on my x-axis because this is horizontal collision. I want to check if I'm running into something. So it's not enough about the x where I'm standing right now. I have to go in and I have to use my movement. As you know, up here, this is what determines my movement right now. This is this tiny variable HSP. So, x plus HSP. That way it's gonna say x plus the amount of pixels I'm going to move. Is this anything I'm gonna run into here? Oh, Anna's hosting. Did the hosting alarm go off? Because I just keep forgetting of looking over that screen. Hi Benighted. God, everybody. I hope Anna's doing better. She looks kind of sad and sick, and I really, really just want it to be over so that she can enjoy what she's doing right now. Oh, that's awesome. Hosting, yay! As you can see, I'm better talking to the camera than keeping tabs on everything here. But thank you so much for the host. That's awesome. Anyone who doesn't know what I'm doing, I'm in the middle of my second tutorial on GameMaker about doing a platform game. Last time, chat got to vote on who's going to be the main character, and I'm just quickly going to show our main character. There were some suggestions of dodos and monkeys, but the one we ended up with is the bear. So, I'm not using the notepad that you are seeing, is just my notes for what I'm talking about, Bloody Albatross. And the language that GameMaker uses is called GML and is GameMaker's own language. So it's pretty reminiscent of things like Java and Flash. That's my best description. It's very, very simple. There's a lot of pre-made functions made especially
aimed at people doing games. So you don't have to write all your functionalities if you don't want to. You can use some of the built-in ones. Well, I want to keep it simple as well, Zazu. I think it's not fair if all tutorials are aimed at people who already know how to code and how to do graphics. And this is all about don't be scared about starting up doing something. This entire graphic is basically made with the ellipsis tool in GIMP and then put into different layers. So I can animate them as I see fit. Like you can see here, I can move around all different parts of the eyes. I can move the eyebrows for different expression, move the arms up and down. Everything is kind of like that. No, you can't directly reuse your code, but if you like doing your very own code, for instance, in Visual or something like that, there's really no reason for you to be doing GameMaker, because it's pretty much for wanting to do things in GameMaker. What you get out of it when you're done with it is that it has a very easy publish function that publishes specifically to all the different platforms you could want to publish to. And one of the other reasons I chose it is that I was so lucky that the Pro version was on a Humble Bundle recently. The proprietary language I really don't have a problem with, because basically any language is a proprietary language. And if you have problems with that, just do pseudo code to start with. Just write down approximately what you want to happen and adjust it to the certain language that you're working with. This is a very easy language. So, I was in the middle of a horizontal collision, or trying to avoid one, rather. So, horizontal collision, x-axis plus what presently is in your variable of your horizontal speed after you've gone all through all of these calculations up here. So, if you're pressing, you remember, if you're pressing the left key, you get a 1 or a minus 0, right key, 0 or 1, go through all of that. You got your AHP from that, because that would be your move, the result of this, times your move speed, the variable we have in the create event. Yeah, Benny Bear, he is cute. Oh, you were talking about the graphic. Oh, sorry. So here the variable that I just grabbed out of GameMaker, place meeting, to check, and it required my x coordinate, y coordinate, and object wall in this case, because I put in an object wall. In a later tutorial, because I'm probably not going to do it this time, I'm going to put in something about colliding with enemies as well. So collisions is anytime you have objects that kind of overlap. So, oh, that's okay, Bloody Albatross. This is a stream where there's coding and graphics, which means all opinions are pretty valid. As long as people don't trash what I'm doing, you are free to share your opinions with me and everyone else in chat. So, back to the coding part. Yes. Now, let me see what I was doing. I got totally lost now. If place meeting, there I was. Yes, in my notes. I'm gonna do something called a while loop. A while loop is something that it's a piece of code that will keep on happening as long as this is true. So, as long as when I check in front of me in the direction I'm going on the x-axis, there is a place meeting between me and the wall. There's no thing, nothing going on here, but I'm gonna do the wild thing and see if I can explain it underway. So, gonna put in some more of my brackets because I love my brackets. Plus, I'm gonna do more than one set, so make sure that you make them in sets if you're not that used to it. So, I'm gonna go into here, the first set of brackets, and I'm gonna write while. While is a bit like if. It's a set condition that the GameMaker knows how to work with, and most compilers you work with, if you do any kind of language, knows how to work with these kind of expressions. So while something is true, what do we want to be true? Let's say not place meaning. When I do this exclamation mark, it means not. So this place meeting here is not happening in this. So, place meeting, same things we worked with before, and X and Y and the object wall. So let's start by putting those in there. Yeah, I know, bloody albatross. So the brackets, and I mentioned it once before, the red one, I think it was, commented on it, that you can do if statements in one sentence without putting what's going to happen if your if is true inside brackets. And it's true that you can, but it doesn't mean that you necessarily should. Because brackets helps you make sure that pieces of code is separated from other pieces of code. So you don't accidentally have two pieces of code happening right after each other that shouldn't have happened after each other because of a missing bracket. So it can change the entire outcome of one of these expressions if I didn't have this bracket down here. So that was the object more. Now, my X here, I'm going to put something in here that is, well, I have a hard time explaining this one because this is from the tutorial and it's a value I haven't worked with before. So maybe someone who has worked with it before can explain why I'm doing it. But it's called sign HSP there. But what I'm doing in this expression, after this, HSP, yeah, I was looking at the notes for my vertical collision. I need an extra set of brackets because now I started up something else. First I did the if as a condition. I'm going to do a second condition. That's a while. This is holding true. So I'm going to put another pair of squiggly brackets in here. There we go. And I'm going to take a drink. I can see I've already been on for an hour and a half, and my beer is getting slightly warm. So luckily it's one with ginger. Cheers, everyone. Are we following you, Welshie? Sure, everyone, go follow Welshie. I'm not sure when he's going to stream next time, but I'm sure it's going to be awesome. So, let's get this on. Plus equals sine HSP. Now all I immediately know is that this one returns a value. This sine HSP, it returns a value. And that value I do change my x with.
So sorry for burping on camera, but I love beer, but it has side effects.
Now, I'm going to go down here, and I'm going to check for a bit. Do I have all my brackets? No, because I keep pushing that one down to get that bracket up there as well. So it's in the right place. So I have this set of brackets. As you can see, I push in the text. That helps me make sure I have all my brackets because they will be aligned atop each other like this. I can see I have an error somewhere with a symbol expected in line 25. Part 1. No, that's supposed to be there. That's supposed to be there. I'm going to go in here. I'm going to say HSP equals 0. There. Basically, what it's saying is if I run into a wall, I'm going to set my speed to 0. Why? Well, because I'm not going to move anymore when I run into a wall. And if this isn't true anymore, I can move on because I'm not running into a wall. So that's going to be HSP plus equals. Nope, it's going to be X plus equals HSP. I'm getting confused now. One of the reasons of this is that I haven't commented as much as I should on all parts of the code, and that's why I keep reminding people, comment for God's sake, comment. If you need more explanation for this one later on, I'll be happy to go and jump back in the tutorials on your account and figure out what it was this one was about. But right now, what you want to know here is, am I running into a wall? That is the main question that this collision is checking for. So the first collision check, am I standing on something and can I jump? And the second collision is, am I running into a wall horizontally? So. Besides standing on something, let's try taking what we have. So if I have an error somewhere, I can see. Let's see there. Oh, I'm missing a bracket. There we are. That should help that one. That was a bracket. And that's missing a bracket too. There we go. That's our brackets accounted for. So far, this should be pretty nice. So let's try building a room with just what we got here. It's not going to be perfect in any way. I might get an error when I try to run it, but let's get a bit more than just the coding done. So this is a room. I place my my cursor up here in the corner, and I just scroll out using the wheel. The reason I do it up here in the corner is, otherwise, if I do it here, the scrolling will be centered on that point. So when I do it up here, I make sure I get my entire room in here. Now, I put the speed to 60, I put a width, and I put a height. Now I want to put some objects in there, because I know I've created two objects, an object and an object wall. I have one problem with the object wall, it doesn't have a sprite. So let's close the room down for a little bit before we can put the wall in. And here it says, no sprite, I'm just going to say new. And I'm going to make it in Gamemaker to get it done quickly. Oh, the kiddies are just torturing Anders because there's 20 minutes to food, so it's mostly that way around. I'm going to do a sprite. I'm going to call it SPR underscore war, just to keep the consistency with the naming up. I'm going to edit a sprite, and by that I mean I'm going to make a new one. 30, now I'm going to make it 16 by 16. I can change the sizes a lot when I go into the room, but this is fine for now for me. As you can might remember from last time, I'm using the good numbers, the good IT numbers. 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, keep just doubling upwards, and those are the numbers we're working with. So I'm going to do 16 by 16 here. I'm going to edit it. I'm going down here on the edit. And I'm basically just going to make it, let's say, blue. So this one up there, grab a bucket, turn it all blue. That's perfect. That's my wall sprite. There we go. Pretty easy done. I'm centering it because I like centering stuff. Okay, sprite wall, nothing to do here, nothing about that, nothing in the object at all, because the collision coding is happening in the player object, so I don't have to do it here. So, okay to that. Let's go back into the room we created, scroll out a bit, and start placing some objects. So, let's just make the room a little bit bigger. There we go. So, in here, on these different, here you can choose objects. And in objects, I'm going to start out by grabbing a wall. Now I'm going to click, left click, and there I have my wall. As you can see, it's scalable, which is pretty nice. Now I did that. There we go. It's scalable, so I can simply just drag it to a length that I want and just put it in there. Create one more. Scale it as I want it. Put it in here as well. We're just going to do like a very fast level here. That's going to not be anything very special about that. I think that's long enough. There we go. Got one more there. Let's make something we can jump onto. Like that. Oh, delete that one. If I can get it. There we go. Delete. And let's just put our player object in here as well. Objects, choose the object, object player, place there. This is basically a room. I can go in and I can say backgrounds, draw a background color. Right now it's gray. I can change that one to green, like that. Or I can put in a background image. Right now I'm just going to use this. Now, let's see. When I press this one, it's going to try to play the game. So it's going to compile everything it's got and see if this is runnable. Well, it was runnable enough that I got to this part. As you can see, nothing is happening. I'm just hanging in the air. That means there's some coding still not happening. And as you remember, we were in the middle of doing vertical collision, so that might be why. So let's just close this down again and go back into our object and our step and back to this. So, horizontal collision. Vertical collision is going to pretty much the same thing. So I'm basically just going to copy this. And you might say, but didn't we already do a vertical Vertical collision? Not really. We were really just checking if we were standing on something. We didn't really check collision both ways. So this is like the separate collision. So instead of horizontal, I'm calling it vertical, of course. So it's not, am I running into a wall, really? It's, am I colliding? Up or down? Yeah. Once again, use the command lines. They're really, really good at this. So I'm doing the same piece of conditions that I put up here to make sure that I'm only moving if I'm going in the right direction. Now down here, of course, I'm going to have to put this one that was from the horizontal. I'm going to put that one on the vertical instead. That means the y coordinate, and in that case it's going to be VSP and not HSP. So make sure that's VSP, and the same thing up here. Make sure you don't have plus HSP on the X, that instead you have plus VSP on the Y. Let's make sure that's a plus. Let's see, sine HSP, that's going to be a V. HSP, that's going to be a V. That's going to be a Y. That's going to be a Y, and that's going to be a V. Okay, so far so good. Now let's try to see if we can get this to work. The HSP and the VSP is, oh, I can see here I've got something. An error. As you can see here, when you get a code error, it will ask you about something here. And here it's got object zero jump speed not set before reading it. So at step normal event in line 20, it's because it's jump speed. And I'm pretty sure that should have been jump speed normal. So let's go in and change that one. Abort this. Go back in here. Go back into our step event. Where was I when I said jump speed? Let's do that, minus jump speed. And let's do that to normal. Because jump speed normal is something we know. We know from this create event up here. We have our HSP for our present horizontal speed, our VSP for present vertical speed. We've got graph. That in this case is our gravity, the number we add and subtract when we're moving up and down. We have our move speed, which is our maximum horizontal movement speed. Something just happened. What just happened? Did I get a follow or something? Oh, Shaded Areas is hosting. Thank you, Shaded. And welcome to the stream. If you've been here for a while, sorry I haven't noticed. I'm doing my best to get this to run and do some coding and answer some questions at the same time. So in here in the create event, and if you weren't here in the beginning, the create event, that is where you put variables that has to be there from the moment your object is initialized, from the moment it's created in the room. So horizontal speed, present horizontal speed, this variable is set to 0. Vertical speed is set to 0. Gravity is set to 0.2. Its maximum movement speed horizontally is set to 4. And then it's got two jump speeds, because in the game there's going to be your normal jump and you're going to get access to a power up, and that is going to be your other jump speed down here. So 8 and 10 for those. So let's do that. Let's say okay, and let's see if it'll run now. Run the game. There we go. Let's see. Not really anything happening with my keys. Oh, wait, I know why. I'm pressing the arrow keys, and we put them to be A and D instead. So press D, run into the wall, stop, press A until I run into a wall, stop, go back and forth. Let's check the space key. What a nice jump. There we go. So these are like your initial variables. Now you can see here this one is put a bit high. So let's go back into the room and make sure it's something you can actually jump onto. So I'm just gonna grab this one, move it down, and then I can put this, my object for the beginning, basically anywhere. So if I have platforms up here and want to start there, I could put it there. Where I put my player object is going to be where the object is going to be in the beginning of the game. So let's run that once more. So let's see. There we go. We can now jump onto a platform and further up if there was something there to jump on. So that is initial movement. Now, as you, most people who are watching me know, I love doing graphics, whether it's old school graphics with pen and paper or if it's doing computer graphics. And for this game, I've chosen to do computer graphics. The easiest kind I could do, all based on ellipses, all done in layers, so it's used to animate. And I'm just gonna run through some let's move those eyebrows back up so he doesn't look so unhappy. There we go. This is, of course, your front view. I'm gonna try to show you some of the sprites I made simply by moving stuff around here, because I did a jump up and a falling down sprite as well for the next coding I'm going to do in that area. So close without saving, file, open. This is player bear falling. So you can see here, all I really did was I removed a little bit of the smile from the face, moved the arms upwards, and the legs a bit out to the side. So that's the falling animation. So he's gonna look slightly surprised when he's falling. And close that one down, and then there should be another one called Player Bear Jump. This is what the player is going to look like when he's jumping upwards. Of course, I'm going to need to write the code to put these sprites in there, because I have to make sure that and I'm going to base that on the values that we went through today. So if the value is a negative x value, of course my bear is running that way out the screen to the left. And if my I have a positive number, my bear is going to run to the right. So I'm going to do sprites based on the values that we established earlier today. 1 hour and 53 minutes and 1 second. Wow, and I haven't even had a break. You know what? I am going to take a 10-minute break, and then I'm going to be back after that. I don't know for how long, but at least so I can get this, what I'm doing today, rounded off slightly. So, everyone, bear with me. For 10 minutes, I hope you are going to have a lot of fun in chat while I'm gone. yeah, I know, so cat feeding time any minute now, so it's a good time for a break. And with 10 minutes, cats can be fed. So I'm just going to go offline for 10 minutes, so that means I'll be back at a couple of minutes past 10, and I of course hope you'll be here. Otherwise, have fun wherever you're going. See you in a bit. If I can find my pause button. There you go. And now, really see you in a bit.